professional community of ours. I told John that I cited him long before I met him personally, and now he's become sort of an unofficial mentor and advisor to me because I stalk him on Skype, and whenever I see that he's on there, I'll ask him my latest question about community involvement and planning, which he has done internationally. He's a professor at the University of Costa Rica. And when I go to a conference and I see John Hull on the agenda, I just know I'm going to that one because he always makes me think. And so I think he will have a very dynamic 2 hours to do. Make you do the same. John Hull.
Well, welcome to Interpretation
of the Moon.
Today we are going to look at the moon. At the same time, hopefully we'll have an out-of-this-world experience of a growing methodology called Participatory Interpretive Framework. It's going to be a little bit of theory and a little bit of practice to try and get the idea. Well, Amy, already thank you for the introduction. I would add one additional element. And I work for an association or a consortium called the PUP Global Heritage Consortium, which about 15 years ago started developing the methodology and interpretive frameworks. Still a work in progress, but it comes from that. I'll talk a little bit more about that organization. I should also mention that I'm not exactly here alone. If anybody was here with my other session, you know I kind of have an affinity for invisible, non-corporeal co-presenters. So I'd like to present very briefly at Nuno Domingos. And Nuno is the Director of Culture and Tourism at the historic city of Évora, Portugal, which is a World Heritage City. And he actually couldn't be here today, but we'll find ways to represent his being. As I had briefly mentioned as well, the organization is called the PUP Global Heritage Consortium. It's a brief mission, or no, briefly, the mission would be to try and unite people and organizations around the world who are dedicated or very interested in introducing emerging paradigms into heritage management and planning. Public use planning. It was the public use planning methodology of UNESCO before it became a consortium, so for branding purposes, make people laugh and read all kinds of terrible things in different languages, which you can probably guess. So our goal today, then, will be to create, at least partially create, a participatory interpretive framework of the moon. Very briefly, this framework is a hierarchy of messages that link local stories about a heritage site with universal themes, and is designed in such a way that those who use the framework can communicate better about their heritage site to all kinds of different audiences. So what we're going to try to achieve is we're going to go partially through some of the steps, because actually this workshop takes about a full day, plus several days to prepare the framework thereafter. It's hard to squish that into an hour and 20 minutes. But when I skip the step, I'll at least briefly explain what it is so that you know. And then there's additional reading that you can do later if so interested. The documents that you, there's 10 little packets around. There's only 10 because the idea was to share. These are called the examples and illustrations, and we'll be referring to them for examples and illustrations, happily enough, throughout this workshop. Okay. A plan. This is where most plans and heritage sites end up. Well, I didn't have a shelf, otherwise I would have thrown it there, but they end up unimplemented or partially implemented very often on bookshelves. And this is partially or largely because they come out of the old form of development. They come out of a bureaucratic mindset. And what are some of the characteristics of this bureaucratic mindset planning? Well, some of them is making the decisions for local people in these plans. It might be the domination of technical consultants and the exclusion of local people because they're seen as unqualified. These plans very often depend on external funding, do not come from the resources of the site itself. It's considered purely technical aspects. Anything that's political is oftentimes largely ignored or just given lip service, so that those political problems later pop up and torpedo the plan's effectiveness. Most of the time, the participation is only token. You invite people to workshops, they give their opinions, but they really have no power over the plan, or very little power to influence the outcomes of these plans. And oftentimes, these kind of plans, or development in general, is characterized by giveaways, giving things, inviting people, putting them up in nice hotels. These are all different forms of coercion to get people to behave in the way the planners would like them to do. So what is the result of this? Obviously plans that fail, that end up on the bookshelf. But if we look at any kind of international development, we see agricultural machines sitting in fields rotting because the local people didn't have the resources, the knowledge, or the interest in keeping them running. Oftentimes communities find themselves growing more dependent on foreign donors, more indebted. They lose their identity. So all kinds of negative effects happen from this development process. And of course, plans pile up. And interpretation, as a part of the development process, really hasn't been an exception to this. Interpretation very often is in the hands of experts, like all of us here, myself included, where very often power isn't shared very much with the participants or the stakeholders. Even though oftentimes we say it is, but it isn't. I want to emphasize that I'm definitely not excluded from this. I worked in a consultant team in 2005 in the Lumber Heritage Region of Pennsylvania, the second largest heritage area in the United States. And we had a team of consultants and we worked together and we did some really cool things with this interpretive plan for this massive region. We used GIS and we mapped itineraries according to a categorized database, interactive database with our attractions and our different messages all hierarchically arranged. So you could go through any gateway that you wanted. You had at least three different kinds of itineraries for three different markets. It was brilliant, but it didn't get used. It's a nice example that I can use in talks. But that monument of hope is no longer of use.
John, you say it's not used.
Not used by the people in the heritage area. It's on their website, you can find it there.
Nothing in it was implemented?
As far as I know. Now, I always like to make the footnote that things do get implemented in plans. That's why I say no or partially implemented. But very often, not always, but very often the things that get implemented are things that would have been done anyway, even if there were no plan. People use the plan as a platform to do what they want, which is what you're supposed to do. But you don't necessarily need the plan to do those things.
Do you know that they weren't being fully implemented because of a lack of enthusiasm on part of the interpreters or a lack of enthusiasm or response by the audience?
Well, in any particular case, you're going to look at a variety of different factors. Here, my interest is trying to get down to the roots. But if there's a lack of enthusiasm, you have to ask, well, why is there a lack of enthusiasm? Do they not feel ownership for this? Did they not participate or co-create in the plan?
But I'm asking, do you feel that the interpreters didn't feel a part of the plan, or the visitors didn't feel part of the plan, or both?
Well, the visitors aren't responsible for implementing the plan. It would be the managers or stakeholders. So, I'm sure in different cases, it's different depending on who participated or who didn't participate between managers. In other kinds of management plans, oftentimes it's other stakeholders outside the actual managers themselves. Because they don't get political support, they don't show up to the meetings, they don't want to contribute anything because they don't feel it's theirs. But anyway, that's really another talk about why plans in general don't get implemented. There is a new form of development that's arising around the world. Very briefly, some of the characteristics is trying to redistribute power. Participation is about power, even though oftentimes that word isn't used. Redistribute that power so that the locals are making their own decisions, trying to overcome their own barriers. Admittedly, a lot of consultants aren't trained to help them in this new form of development. Oftentimes, they don't have the skills necessary. Wood was talking in his presentation, was that 2 days ago? That was yesterday morning, about this wider vision of interpreters and the need to have additional skills, such as facilitation, which is what I'll be talking about shortly. So we want to revision interpreters so they're not just the traditional outside experts. This new form is somebody who's also a facilitator, who can work with communities to generate meanings, to generate messages that the people feel are truly theirs and not just concocted by outsiders. Concocted is a negative word. We do mind work. Not just developed and fashioned by outsiders. It's a larger role, indeed. It requires new skills that many interpreters don't have, and new attitudes that perhaps they haven't encountered yet. So this is my introduction here to this little, to this brief workshop. As we go through this presentation, I'm going to just show you slides from a few other places where this has been done. Just a different book. So introduction, there's an introduction from Union Island, which is the last island in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, where this is actually going on right now. So let me put my task back on. Here we go. Let me start by saying that the first step in this process is recreating a timeline of history of that particular heritage site. If you happen to be doing a heritage site, but really any object has a history, whatever you're interpreting. So together, the group will create their own timeline. But we're not going to do that in this particular case. That's another couple hours that we don't have to work with. But I'll talk a little bit more about that step in just a moment, so you know what it's about. But what we are going to do now is, everyone please, come over to this side of the room and leave your belongings, except for a pen and a pencil and paper, sorry. And if you could bring those little packets, too, that I had put down, that would be great. And try to stand yourself. But please, come. This is our other space. If we can make a little semicircle right here, or as big as necessary. So the next step after the timeline, which we'll just say imaginatively is over on that wall behind Bold, is we want to create significant attributes about the moon. A significant attribute is really any kind of superlative that you can think of about the moon, from any cultural or scientific or anything at all that's of significance in your mind. So here in this document we have some examples of what significant attributes, not of the moon. Best designed Mayan temples in the Mayan world, where the president was born, the largest whatever of the country, the river with the second strongest rapids in the country, the only one in the region without settlements inside its boundaries, the most strategic position in the biological corridor, etc., etc., etc. Now, these should respond to the focus question of our workshop, which is there right behind Lee, the rising moon, which I will read, so if you turn your heads a little bit. What are the most significant attributes and stories, because an important story about a place is also an attribute, about the natural and cultural heritage of the moon that illustrate and reveal new perspectives about the nature, the universe, and being human? So when you come up with your significant attributes, you wanted to respond to that question. So normally, we would ask the participants to come up with 5 such attributes, give them 15 minutes or so, and then at the end of that, we would ask them to throw out 2. And this is a means of quality control. But since we don't have a lot of time here, and we're not interested in quality, are we? No, that's not the reason. I'm going to give you 3 or 4 minutes to come up with 3 significant attributes about the moon. If, in fact, and why did I pick the moon? Anyone have an idea?
It's a universe.
That's right. If I try to pick any site from any country, other people aren't going to participate. So either we use the Earth or the moon or, I don't know, my hometown or something. But I chose the moon.
We're talking about Phobos, right?
Phobos. Is that where I live?
Or Deimos.
Okay.
Mars.
Oh, right.
Mars.
Mars. Yes.
True. I was making the point that we don't know those.
True, true. Okay. From a distance. We all roughly have the same distance, same relationship to the moon. So I'd like you to write down on the sheet by yourselves 3 attributes, significant attributes. On the back page of those things, there's also a moon list. A moon fact sheet that you can use as reference if you feel that your knowledge about the moon really isn't enough to produce 3. So please, just take 3 or 4 minutes. Mm-hmm. Nope, 10, yeah, you have the chair.
I heard that.
What I know.
But it's a singular exercise by yourself.
I don't know why I give you two.
I don't use cell phones. I'm never going to use the rules. Okay, so I want to keep that list with you, and then you can return to your seats. Since we're talking about heritage, probably a good idea, very briefly, to have heritage, without getting into the deep discussions about authenticity and integrity, which could very easily turn into a workshop of the whole day. So I'm just going to use an extremely minimal definition of heritage. We could say that heritage divided by a resource gives us, what's the remainder after we divide heritage by a resource? Any math people here? No. Meaning. Now, anybody who studied algebra knows that if we rearrange this and we go resource times meaning, will give us heritage. And of course, the meaning in this case would refer to positive meanings about a particular heritage object. And in fact, how do we give meaning to a heritage to a resource object? Through experiences, true, which then unleashes a process of what in your mind?
Association.
Interpretation, thanks very much. Through interpretation, whether it's done through the help of an outsider or simply something we do in our own mind. We don't usually refer to interpretation as just a normal human psychological process, but in fact, that's what happens. For example, we take this ordinary rock here. This would be nothing more than a resource. But if through a little bit of magical interpretation, I inform you that its true reality is not just any old rock. That this rock, in fact, is a piece of the, well, the picture's not up there, of the moon. And once I let you know, feel free to pass it around. But please return it to me when you're done. But what, now that you know that it's the moon, it's just that little simple piece of information, the power, it turns into heritage. simply by a little bit of adding a little bit of meaning to it. Maybe it's a lot of meaning, depending on your association. But these meanings are everything about interpretation, and not just that. Meanings are almost everything in community development. It's meanings that give communities pride. It's meanings that give communities and people identity. They give us sense of place. They influence our self-perception, our self-worth, or the opposite, if meanings are negative. Meanings have a great influence over the psychological welfare of individuals and communities, as well as the role or the image of a site in the marketplace, once again, is mediated by meanings. To give an example of a couple resources that were turned into heritage and important meanings for the identity of sites where we're working with this methodology, this Roman temple, which is over 2,200 years old, in Évora, is the icon. It's a great source of pride for the people of Évora, including my partner, Nuno Domingos. Ashton Lagoon in Union Island is considered one of the most complete, one of the most beautiful lagoons in all of the St. Vincent and Grenadines, and one of the most beautiful, not necessarily the photo reflects it, but one of the most beautiful in the Caribbean as well. And this is not new information. It's 500 years the conquistadors knew this same piece of information when they arrived at the Americas. When they came and they wanted to take over the Americas, thank you very much. Everyone touch a piece of the wood? I actually lied, it's not a piece of the moon. But you can see that interpretation of meanings can be used for evil as well as good.
Authenticity was a problem too.
As well. But if you believed it was real, then it was. For a little while. So when the conquistadors arrived, all right, well, I'm not in the Americas anymore, am I? When they crossed the ocean, and are used the same when they arrived here, 400 or 500 years ago, and they wanted to find gold, and they had to defeat the Mayans and the Aztecs to do that, they knew that crushing the meaning of the Mayans and the meaning of the Aztecs was a principal way of subduing them, not just the use of swords. So what did they do? The Spanish came and they burnt the materia medicas of the Mayas. They destroyed the books. They destroyed the symbols. They built their Catholic churches right on top of the Mayan temples. It was a huge affront, and it crushed the meanings, the stories that were truly important for the self-identity of that culture. Of course, that's a universal, because that happens, has happened to indigenous and non-indigenous people all over the world, all throughout history. So again, that's not a new revelation. And in fact, but what maybe is a new revelation is that when people think about the places that they live, it's through a web of interconnected beliefs. It's not something you summarize in just one or two sentences. It's complex. But oftentimes it's very poorly articulated by the people who live there, or even people who don't live there. I've had the experience on numerous occasions of asking a park manager, "So what's special about your park?" He or she might answer, "Wow, it's got great biodiversity," or "It's got some really old archaeological sites on it." Well, that's not a very deep observation about your site for someone who's been working here for a long time. But that's not to say they don't have a deep, insightful perception of their own site. Is that they've probably not had the opportunity to really sit down and try to articulate those meanings that are deeper and intertwined among many meanings in their mind. They have not had that opportunity. Which is a little bit ironic when you think about it, because all traditional communities, indigenous communities, have been articulating the meaning about their cultures for hundreds and thousands of years, transmitting that meaning through well-articulated stories, orally, from generation to generation. But in recent times, a new force has arisen in the world that is threatening that transmission, threatening that articulation of the special meanings about places and about objects, which would be what? What's a big force in the world that's destroying these meanings? And it's not the Spanish this time. Well, they're participating, but we all are. Globalization. Globalization is this big giant blender. I'm homogenizing. Does anyone whose language is English second language not know the word homogenize?
I'm not sure how to explain.
Homogenize is when you take various different things and you mix them all together and everything is the same, like in a blender. And that's what's happening in our world, is a great deal of homogenization, which is the arch enemy of authenticity. In a way, these meetings about heritage places is kind of sacred knowledge. It's the soul of a community, the soul of a place. These meetings help determine the position in a marketplace. You could say they might even help determine the position of a community in the universe. I mean, really, that's what spirituality is about. Trying to figure out where we are in the universe. What is our role in that universe? Just an example, does anyone know which city this is? This is a fairly large cityscape image. Anyone dare to guess? It's not an unknown city.
It's got a moon.
It does have a moon, like many things on certain kinds of Earth. What's that? I'll give you a hint. It's in Eurasia. Not a very good hint. This is Moscow. But it really could be anywhere, right? Because the architecture and the style has become international. It's become globalized. And although there are still very iconic locations in Moscow, I'm sure there's far fewer than there used to be 100 or 200 years ago. That's true of most places. So anyway, now, to look at a couple photos of the creation of the timeline in another place. Here's the timeline being, here's the timeline up here. There's all kinds of different events. And then basically, the community, this is in Union Island, they take these events and they break them up into periods. And then they name these periods. And these periods hopefully offer insight into the process that we're coming up with right now. But why do we do that? We analyze this history collecting. We could just read it in a book, right? But that would be a historian's interpretation of history. It wouldn't have been generated collectively among the stakeholders in the audience, something that they can feel a greater ownership for. As well, as I mentioned, it generates possible themes.
Just a quick question.
Sure.
I don't know if you've had any experience working with kind of non-Western cultures where the timeline is not the traditional, like the linear timeline is not the traditional way of viewing history. So I'm thinking of like of both the Inuit communities and Inuit communities, and time is much more cyclical and that kind of thing.
Sure. No, I haven't worked with indigenous, but we have done this in Indonesia, and we've done this in Vietnam. So it works in modern, at least, Eastern cultures. But it's a good point, and that would require some certainly innovation on the theme, on the methodology, in case that's a really good point. Someday. And we also are generating attributes and stories that will be useful for the activity that we're about to continue with, as well as launching a consensus process, trying to show that this is a different kind of conversation than the people are accustomed to. Okay. Everyone? To divide into groups. We have four groups. We have the Selenites, for those who don't know, anyone who hasn't heard of Jules Verne, the author from France.
Sorry,
that's it. Have you heard of the author Jules Verne, a French from 18-something?
Yeah.
He wrote a lot of books. Well, one of his books, it was Journey to the Moon or something like that, or Man Insect. Anyway, the people who lived on the moon were vegetable insects that he called Selenites. It's not a word you hear every day. Then we have the astronauts group. We have the Transformers group. I don't know if anyone has seen the latest Transformers movie from the Dark Side of the Moon. Doesn't matter. Very American. And then we have the moon colonists. So I'm going to divide you up very quickly, and then you can go to your group location. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. There's other ones, don't worry. So if you can proceed to your particular brand of inhabitants.
Right. Isn't it funny how we have an instant reaction? Yeah.
Four.
Wait, there's only
four.
Three.
Four.
Three.
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 Three. Three.
Three. It can't be two threes.
Four.
You are four.
I'm four. Yes.
How about you be number three? You look like a transformer. The yellow one. No. Okay, so now what I need you to do is to combine your responses that you have. Each one of you has three, correct? And the first step you want to do is eliminate any repetitions. Just cross them right out. And then, as a group, with minimal discussion, if you please, it's not normally how we do that, but with minimal discussion, you need to select nine. 4 times 3 is 12, so you have to eliminate just a few. Hopefully the repetition elimination eliminates the need for more discussion, but if you have still some, you need to choose which ones you think are most appropriate. And then we will put them on cards. This is an example card here. Up to 7 words, not including the word of. Neat, black, and big. So that we can read it from the opposite side of, or at least halfway across the room. I will momentarily pass out some markers and some paper. In the meantime, and again, I don't want to spend more than 5 minutes if possible, quickly choose those 9 that you're going to put on cards. Okay, go ahead.
So, can she say somewhere?
What is the name?
Passing the first one to the cards.
So you want us to get rid of everything that we had in common, right?
Oh, you know, we want to have one. Three people have the same thing.
Are we trying to come up with
4 to 7 words?
I think there's a separation between psychic and for me it was much
when this song ends I'd like to be done
that it's not the everything oh this one agriculture the tides
transformation discovery
Gotta be a member forward if there's an idea.
I can visualize what's on the moon. Maybe I'm privileged to have that.
I think there's two different concepts here. One is this idea of scientific discovery, like the Earth.
4 to 7 words.
And then there's also this ambition.
Because 2 is really not going to be a good idea.
That goes back to the
To let your reach exceed your grasp. That's sort of the definition of what trying
to do. Be the first to
double worship.
Yeah, I mean, it's worth it. You can't even verse there.
We got time to transition.
Okay, you need to be finishing up now.
Y'all have a minimum forward?
I don't know.
Yeah.
He won't tell you.
Maybe I'll write on the back of this one.
If you need another piece of paper.
Well, we made a mistake.
It should be a phrase, not a list. The idea should be clear.
The idea is to fill up the whole.
Just to remind you, this is a model example of what the card should look like. Four to seven words, a complete phrase, that's no verb. Or no, that doesn't begin with a verb anyway. Okay?
Nine.
Theory. Well, at least start with three.
Okay.
In theory, everyone had three. Okay, if you could reincorporate, she can continue writing. You can whisper to her in the meantime. Okay, would you? So, now, I'm going to ask each group, collectively, to choose your three most important, or your three clearest, or your three most favorite attributes on the cards. So as a group, quickly choose those three.
We've already done.
Okay, good. Have you done it already?
Yeah.
And you can look at them for me. Three most important?
Yeah.
Okay. We're going to put them on the wall? Randomly. But only on a weekend.
Or branch.
Well, there's all kinds of
Poetry,
and history.
Some people.
Yeah,
I think there are a couple that are
So which do you prefer as far as being evocative or clear? This one kind of fits with the stories, legends, and superstitions.
Well, this one I was thinking more like.
Okay, so if you've chosen, could you please put them on the wall, on a leaf or on a branch, in any order randomly, and not next, not immediately next to another card.
Things can seem and attack you, so it's always had that duality of fear and comfort. You can see what you're being seen.
We don't have anything about this yet.
Put your three up, please. Anywhere, randomly, not touching anybody else. Okay, good. All right, now the next step is we now have to, what's called, interview the cards. Because the idea on a lot of the cards will not necessarily be clear to us, and we want to make sure there's a consensus understanding of the cards. So we will just take a look at the first one. It provides the basis for human calendars. Supposedly, I imagine that would mean the cyclical rotation. So that's kind of the idea, right? That's what it is. Okay, agricultural calendar works by the moon. Okay, pretty clear. If anyone doesn't understand something, please. Okay. Opposition contrast. Well, you can see here that it's less than four words. And because of that, it's actually complicating what the idea is. So can I ask what you mean by that?
Opposition, contrast, that's, we use the moon in many ways, from cultural or natural, to put in opposition to sun, moon, light, dark. Some cultural say this is the power of men and this is the power of woman. Is it, if you see
it, just to establish contrast.
Yeah.
So it's a metaphor for contrast? Could that, is that fair?
Right. Yeah. Okay.
That I think, I guess. A metaphor for Halloween mystery, again, breaking the four-word rule. What about Halloween?
Yeah.
What does it have to do with the moon?
In this case, was Americans say Halloween. It's have a cultural context. Mystery, whereas it's when see about mystery, it's related to darkness. And moon is always there.
So the moon is mystery.
Okay.
Yeah, or Bell's mystery, or it's related to mystery.
It also represents mystery. Fair enough. Okay, high tide, low tide affects nature. Is that clear? Time, change, transition, seasonality. That's a list. What binds this list? What's the idea that binds this list? The group who produced it?
It's like the same as the calendar. It's the notion of using the room to mark the passage of time
or
the changes.
Okay.
Or
change. So it's the cycles again. Change, cycles of change. Delta. Unlike humans, never shows backside. Okay. Poetic. Well, what's the idea behind the poetry? Because we could probably interpret that in multiple different ways, and we'd like to have just one interpretation for this exercise.
It's a thing. It's how do you say, steadfast, or it's always the same, basically.
Oh, okay.
So, no, no, it's the same.
Hunt, I see.
It's, well, you change it, but it's still...
it's a bit of a mystery because we're looking at one side of it all the time. Unlike other celestial bodies that are going around and seeing different aspects, it always has an unrevealed side.
All right. That
exposing yourself.
You just expose an element of yourself. Always has an unrevealed side.
Yeah, there's always a mysterious side or an unrevealed side all the time. I'm only looking at one side. That's what we're going
to see. I just spelled it wrong, but I think we get it.
Perhaps that is. I never thought of it. Maybe that is the reason we say someone knows someone is revealing their backside.
Okay, invoke cycles of nature and human change. Okay. Does that need elaboration? Is that okay?
Human change. Okay,
welcome.
We're also talking about the human change was like people going crazy, they blame it on the moon, falling in love. It's like the moon sort of invokes that in humans.
Those are cyclical changes, right?
Not necessarily.
Well, it is for a werewolf, but...
Yeah, I mean, we're a werewolf, yes, cyclical, but like when someone's gone crazy, they, right. You know, in the United States and other cultures, they say, you know, it was the full moon tonight. You know, everyone's crazy out there.
The behavior change.
Yeah, lunacy, exactly.
Governor Moonbeam.
Good word, lunacy. Affects cycles on Earth. Yeah, okay. Human, natural cycles. Inspire stories, legends, and superstitions, okay? In cultures all across the world. Okay. Illuminates our lives in so many ways. That's kind of a multi-interpretation. Can we land onto one meaning? I mean, yes, it literally illuminates, and that, of course, is an important one that no one's mentioned yet.
Well, that's it. It was intended to be a double.
Oh, okay.
So
well,
it,
yeah,
it literally know. Illuminates, and it also illuminates, kind of like that one, inspirational stories, art, literature, music.
Uh-huh, of course. It is clever, but for our purposes, it needs to have just one meaning, because we can't split the card up into two pieces. We could put it onto two cards, but since the second meaning, you say, is already represented here, then we're not lacking that meaning. In such case, let's regard this literally, because this hasn't been mentioned anywhere else.
Literally.
All right, so our next task here is we want to take these 12 cards and we want to combine them in 4 to 6 pairs, just pairs, two cards, and we want to link these pairs through to the degree possible, a new insight, a new relationship. We don't want to link them just because they might have similarity of words. Okay? So I'm open to take suggestions.
Can I ask a question?
Sure, please.
So we're not grouping them based on meaning?
No, it is meaning. But we're looking for relationships between cards.
Relate to each other.
That relate to each other, hopefully in a way we haven't thought of before. And we don't want to relate them just because they have the same words, which would be superficial and relevant.
But because they have the same meaning. We're linking them because they have the same meaning. Because I heard two different things there. I heard, yeah, we're linking them because they have the same meaning. Uh-huh. And then I heard new relationships,
right.
Which to me...
Actually, I never said because they have the same meaning.
Okay, so...
But that is a relationship. If you can't think of a new relationship, then you can pick them because they're the same or close enough. We don't generate anything new
in our interpretive framework if we link things that are just the same. But a lot of times that's what we have to do because we cannot think of a new relationship between them. But to the degree we can generate new ideas, the richer our product will be.
New meaningfulness.
Like oil and vinegar?
New dressing. Meaningfulness.
Uh-huh. Trying to make dressing. Okay, got it.
Now, in fact, to be honest, a lot of these have pretty much the same meaning, which means that some groups gave us cards with the same meaning, which, of course, is not what we asked for. We asked for the three clearest, your favorite, but not the same. In any event, we'll work with what we have. Okay, suggestions. How might we pair some of these? Again, try to think of a new one.
The scientific discovery relates to never showing its backside.
What card are you looking at?
The two.
Okay, that's one.
That one, and the one below it.
I missed this one. Sorry. I didn't see this card. Scientific discovery to understand. What does that have to do with the moon? I don't see the moon in this card.
It's an object of scientific
discovery. Space exploration.
It's like trying to discover, is there life there? Is there water there? Is there... what's the composition of rocks from there?
So it inspires discovery, maybe? Yeah. Or at least space exploration?
Agriculture calendar works by the moon can be, it's just our forefathers did based on the moon calendar. Then later, from now, we can see the link between scientific, things, right. Discovery.
Well, let me just finish clarifying this card, and then we'll get to the idea. So this is about inspiring at least space exploration, if not beyond just space exploration. Is that fair?
Mm-hmm. Well, people always wanted to understand what's going on with the moon. Why is it doing what it's doing? How do we get there? What's on it?
What's on the dark side?
Inspired. Uh-huh. A lot of the early forms of science, the moon played a pretty big role in it.
Okay, good. Now, who was the person who was making the initial suggestion? Go ahead.
I can see a connection between the exploration, and it's in the way the moon inspires exploration, because it has a dark side.
Okay.
And we all have dark sides, and maybe there's a connection to make with our own internal worlds.
Okay, so this mystery, this unrevealed side, motivates the exploration. Alright, is that people okay? Now at any time we can break these up and we can readjust them. Absolutely nothing is written. Well, let's see if we can get these close enough with this layout. I think so. That's clearly a pair. Another pair?
What about the Halloween, the mystery one?
Okay.
The behavior change. So
this one.
Yeah, so it kind of leads us to be thinking about the nature of stories in our lives and the stories that we associate with the moon in terms of werewolf stories and witches and things like that.
Is it you talking about this card?
Yeah.
So how does the representation of mystery lead to natural human behavior change?
Because when we don't understand,
what's that?
When we don't understand certain attributes of human behavior, sometimes we use the mystery and the danger and the fear that's associated with the moon to explain it. Like you're saying, like when someone goes insane and we used to believe it was the full moon, or someone falls in love with, at the spur of the moment, it was the full moon that caused that.
So this mystery has sort of an explanatory power.
Yeah, the mystery of ourselves we evolve with the mystery of the moon.
Interesting. Okay. Good. All right. Another one? We can also link things that are identical. If we see they're identical, we should put them together if they truly are identical.
What about illuminating our lives in many ways together with inspired stories, legends, and superstitions?
Yeah. Well, we decided that this is literal illumination, and this is the metaphorical. This was the double meaning.
But they're both, don't they? There are links. The fact that it illuminates the night for us, if we were talking about it, invokes both comfort and fear, which usually are the basis of stories, legends, and superstitions.
Okay, so interesting. We're going to actually link the double meaning which you had linked to begin with.
Because it literally, when you're out at night and there's no moon and there's a fear that you're surrounded by darkness, the moon could be a comfort. But at the same time, you have a fear of the full moon because it can all of a sudden you're visible as a predator too.
So
but it also it casts shadows that are not familiar to us, as shadows in the daytime. So that can also create new ways of movement.
All right, we have three. Let's get at least one more pair. We'd like to move on.
Affect cycles on Earth and agricultural calendar works by the moon.
Okay, you're saying this one?
This
and which one?
The affect cycles on Earth.
Affect oh, this one?
Yeah.
Well, okay, that's pretty clear, no?
Right.
Well, good. I mean, we can. Are there any that are almost identical? Basis for human calendar, agricultural calendar. Maybe we can put this one.
Seasonality and calendars too. The one diagonal down from you.
Where's
that? Right in front of you.
Right.
Time change, transition, seasonality.
Oh, okay.
And the one you just took down.
Good enough. All right.
High tide, low tide is also conscious. So you could put that metaphor for conscious. High tide, low tide.
True. Do you want to put high tide, low tide with metaphor for contrast?
Yeah, actually, because people use high tide, low tide as metaphors for conditions and situations that you get into.
It is, it's true. It is a metaphor. All right, that's not bad.
It's a slight change.
All right, now, the cards that you have remaining in your hand, now I want three more cards of ideas that are different, that do not currently appear on this wall. We're doing this to try to achieve diversity of ideas, quickly getting to the diversity that's been represented in this group. Yes. The new people just, or you can pick a group or just work with this group. If there's three other groups, if each one of you could just join one of the groups,
yeah,
that would be great. There's one over here, one over here, and one over here. So please come on in.
Reach
for the moon. Yeah.
If I see the history of science to discover
okay, I need your three up in the wall. Please pick your three. I know you're having a good conversation.
Discover the moon was the only
But you shouldn't be writing new messages. You shouldn't be writing new purchases. You should be choosing the one that you have already.
You don't have any.
We
were
okay.
The moon is also a mood of the humans.
Well, then take advantage of what happened. At least one other.
So cooperation
you're left-handed
and
I am too.
Inspired
to
cooperation
and
I think your three.
what we only have two.
Well, you should have had 9 cards, so
we have 8.
Well, 3 plus 2, you should still have more than
just. We thought a few of these were a little repetitive to what was
on. All right, just cover those.
I knew just what the plan is that we meant to actually
be able
to expand. During many years, the challenge was to
Okay, can I have you all back, please? Amy.
Good view of the room.
Oh. Well, I've fallen down on my job.
All right, now, we need to interview the new card. We'll try to do this with rapidity here. Okay, one moon for our Earth. I guess that means literally, I pretend one moon. It's more of an attribute of the Earth than the moon, but I suppose that's an Earthling perspective, isn't it? The moon, from the moon's point of view, it only has one planet around which to rotate, so I guess.
I think it's also symbolic of this notion of like a shared kind of universal.
Okay, we want to get the original meaning of the card. Gives an astronaut a place to go, although we haven't gone there in a long time, so if you're an astronaut hoping to go to the moon, you could be unemployed. Lunar birth predicts future. Does someone mean, do you mean the creation of the moon itself?
No, I mean, this is my... Because actually my birthday is February 11th, and based on the calendar, it should be March, but when I see the my futures, like a fortune teller, they based on the lunar birth date.
So it's sort of an astrological interpretation.
Yes.
Okay. Common to all on Earth. Okay. Again, just because I have clarity doesn't mean any other people do, so please speak out if you think it needs further clarification. Inspires international cooperation and global benefit.
Okay. You should say provides global benefit.
Provide, okay. To me it sounds a bit vague. In what sense are we referring to here? I guess it was your group.
We're talking about like the International Space Station, yeah. And the fact that the moon is a common factor for all of us, that when we usually try to do something regarding the moon, we're working together. And then it was also mentioned that it provides a global benefit for all of us.
Got it. Specifically with respect to the space project, right?
For that part, yes.
Is that fair? So there can only be one part per card, one idea per card. In the case where you're convinced that there are two ideas on a card, we do have the option of taking the idea and putting on another card. But for this activity, I think we're going to move on. Do you like to take
it? Yeah, I just wanted to mention that it's also a big lamp for the world at night. So it's the benefit, the global benefit.
Well, we have a card that talks about the illumination somewhere.
Okay.
Oh yeah, I think it's down here. Only one idea per card. Okay, what else? Creates lunar eclipse, makes the Earth, Moon, something size. What's this word?
Same size.
Oh, same size. All right. Oh, I see the M. Creates the lunar eclipse, makes the Earth and Moon the same size. In perception.
No, in reality.
In reality.
This is my personal experience of a complete eclipse of the sun.
And then obviously the moon is far smaller than the sun, and they're different distances from Earth, but when they align up, they are exactly the same size in the sky.
Okay. They're aligning up. Perception, right? They're not the perception.
They're not but the perception for us on Earth, I'll find.
Right, okay, so you're extraordinary.
Okay. Anyone else we have? You hope to find solutions to sustainable issues on Earth. How does the moon do that?
I think it's that increasingly there's discussion about if we can't be sustainable on Earth, where else are we going to live? And in some circles they talk about the moon as
not. It's always the option.
Mars falls into that category, too. As well as every other planet from in there on out.
And starship. So.
Conquest and ambition to colonize. Does the moon create that ambition, or is it the object of that ambition? It's the object of that ambition. Okay. I'm not sure, again, if that's a characteristic of the moon, though, because everywhere on Earth has been the object of that ambition at some point. Not so?
Well, again, I think there's the universality of everyone can see the moon, so when you're looking at multiple countries and they're like, well, we're shooting for one location, you know, the moon's pretty much up there as a great big goal.
So in a sense, it's a commons. I don't know if that would be a fair idea of what you're saying.
Yes.
The moon is a global commons. Can I put that? Would that be? Is that an S? Is that too far off? Because that is a new idea on this wall. And a very interesting one. And a very relevant one for conservation purposes.
And heritage purposes.
Challenge? This was created at the last minute, I know. Challenge, discovery, space, race, new frontier. Okay. I think we know where you're going on that. So now what I want you to do is you can create new pairs or clusters of more than two, three and four. And we have very little time at this point, so let's do this. Just do a few very quickly. What's one that we can add more than one to create a group of three or four?
What
does
technological technological
see that one?
What is it?
I don't know what that means. But at this point, we're not going to investigate anymore. We don't have time for that.
You could probably connect the giving an astronaut a job to the scientific discovery and inspiring space exploration. And
where is that?
To your left.
Yeah. Well,
right.
Oh, here. Okay, good. All right, is there another one that could go into this group?
Maybe lunar birth predicts future, if you can.
You're saying that could go into this group?
Yes, as a way of figure out new science, to make new science. Astrology can be new science.
Now, would the group, so this is another question we haven't attached yet. Mm-hmm. Would the group agree with that, combining the astrological card with the astronomical card? Certain mentalities would be very against that. Others might not be. Depends on the group.
Actually, that's the cultural-based information. And
science, so maybe with images, legends.
But maybe we'll say that, keep that separate, just as an example of where the consensus would not support a suggestion. It's a demonstration.
Well, there is a commonality of people tending to understand the world around them, and astrology attempts to do that.
That is true.
And there is, you know, they're attempting to understand things through scientific discovery, and space
explorations. Were there more time, we could delve into that a little bit more. And I'm not saying that there isn't a connection between any two cards on this wall. The moon connects all of the cards. But we're looking to go beyond that kind of connection. How about, is there any others that can fit in this group?
The challenge.
All right, the challenge one. All right. So let's assume that we actually... Where did it go? We would go through and we would produce probably 3 to 5 clusters of them. Some of the cards would remain alone because they're ideas that aren't connected, and that's perfectly fine. Some of them would only be 2 or 3 cards each. So then we would go through and we would look at the different clusters, read through them, start with the biggest one, And we were trying to figure out what is this cluster trying to tell us. You know, we're not looking at the individual cards. Well, what is the combined message that's trying to emerge here? So, looking at these cards, I'll just quickly read them. Unlike humans, there's always an unrevealed dark side. And this one inspires space exploration. There's the challenge of space exploration. Astronauts are employed as a result. If we had to pick 3 to 5 words to name this cluster, what is the heart of this cluster? What is it trying to say in just a few words?
Exploration.
Okay, that's not enough words.
Drives human ambition.
And let's not forget about the moon.
The moon drives human ambition.
Okay, the moon drives, you said innovation. Innovation or exploration?
What did you say? Ambition. But I guess innovation and exploration all work together too.
Yeah, exploration.
Okay. So, what else? Other ideas? We don't want to just stop with the first idea because we want to get a diversity.
The unknown is interesting. Or the unknown interests us.
Okay, the unknown motivates us or drives us to explore the unknown aspect of the moon, perhaps. Okay. Well, let's try that for activity purposes. Can you, who's got the nice handwriting? I don't remember. Not you, ever, so I'm sorry. The person who wrote this. No, not that one, that's me. The person who wrote, this is nice handwriting. Who wrote
that's
that?
That's me.
Please. So how did we put that? We said the mystery or the lunar mystery drives human exploration. Is that okay? Is that more of us captures? And if you can make it as big as, I'm trying to fill up the card. Now, had we finished this whole thing, we might produce something like this. Whoops. Something that followed. Now these are completely hypothetical cluster titles, right? Since I knew we weren't going to, I just thought I'd add a few so we could try to do this next part of the exercise. Okay, I'll read them all. A close reminder of outer space, that we're not alone. And there's probably cards that connect to these ideas. The celestial calendar for people and nature. We definitely have a variety of cards that would have produced this. The great frontier for humanity. Pretty similar to the kind of the exploration one. In gravity moves cultures and organisms. Okay, so assuming we had these different emerging messages, then the next question is, can we combine these clusters? Can we produce new meaning, new relationship between these different cluster titles? For that, it's more useful to have 5 volunteers. Can I quickly have 5 volunteers?
I'm just going to interrupt really quickly. We are over time, and coffee break is happening, so we have time to stay and finish.
Yep.
But it's my job to tell you coffee break is happening.
And technically, coffee break starts in about 3 minutes. So anyway, I quickly have 5 volunteers of those who are willing to spend an extra couple minutes here just to finish up. Otherwise, I will choose the volunteers. Ready, so, Lee? Lisa? And James. So, each one of you take one of these cluster titles, put it across your chest, and stand shoulder to shoulder, so we can all see it. Now, I ask you, how can we rearrange these people? Can we put them in a hierarchical fashion? Can we group a few of these titles together? We're trying to extract yet more meaning from these cluster titles that we have here in a consensus fashion. Do we see relationships among any of these titles that we can create?
These two, Lisa. I'm sorry, what's your name? Marisol. These two seem to be similar.
Yep, definitely. And the connection is that drive for frontiers. Uh-huh. Good. Anything else?
The gravity moves cultures and organisms together
with celestial. Yes. Could you please join Jane? All right, so maybe we'll make a little space here because you're actually in a cluster here. Can we do anything else to extract more meaning from these 5? Put one in front of the other, another one behind, create a shape.
Yeah,
Is there a connection between the calendar's cyclical nature and this drive for exploration? Doesn't have to be. Just a question.
I think the relation is the great frontier, and we are not alone.
Okay, fair enough. So Lele, I guess you would move here. All right. So now at this point, I mean, we would continue doing this. But now what we have are called the emerging messages. So the next step, we would be fairly done with this day's workshop. And we would then form a small committee. This committee would be four or five people who would meet at night to try and turn these messages, these emerging messages, into interpretive messages. And one thing they would try to do is what I call the great interpretive leap. Like, how do we take, say, this cluster here and connect it to a universal aspect about nature, about human condition, or about the universe? Anybody have any quick ideas? How would we connect this to a universal theme? It tells us something about the nature of the universe, or the nature of human condition, or the nature of nature.
The universe is not chaotic.
Okay. So maybe we can connect
patterns that we can depend on.
Okay. So maybe about the idea of, which of course the definition of chaos is there are hidden tractors and patterns within chaos as well. So maybe we can take this and try to tie it to that aspect of patterns, hidden patterns, or maybe not hidden patterns. So anyway, these kind of ideas that we would suggest, we would give them to the small committee. And this is where the interpreter has to have very good skills in being able to link ideas and being able to help a group write up a very good, a strong message. Strong, I would use Sam Ham's definition, where if you actually raise his little hairs on your arm when you're reading it. So once you have those messages, ideally the next day, if possible, depending on how you schedule your interaction with your stakeholders, or at a future time, but hopefully as soon as possible, to return this suggestion, this first draft of messages, to the audience and have them feedback. Now, I'm going to show for those who can wait 2 more minutes just an example or two of what a framework might look like on the wall. It's hierarchical, where we would start with, say, 5 primary sub-messages. I think I showed you the temple, right? The temple metaphor. And then we would try to combine, say, these 2 into a primary message and then have one overarching universal message that encompasses all of these sub-messages, or primary messages. Depending on how complex your heritage site is, you might break down these messages into several storylines, or you might actually say each one is a storyline if it's a small heritage object. And then, after that, the small committee, with the help of the plenary, over a period of several days, would then identify stories in your heritage site that you can use to explain, to describe those storylines or those messages. You would also identify the attractions, if your site has multiple attractions, that you would use that would be most appropriate for interpreting these different messages. And then you would also identify existing or planned products that could be converted, or maybe already do, interpret these messages. So at the end, there's no real end, but at least at the end of this first draft, you have, try to imagine, and I can show on the screen in just a moment, a table. In the top table, in the top row, you have the overarching message. Then in the row underneath it, you have the primary messages, usually about 2 to 5. Under that, if it's complex enough, you might break those down into sub-messages or storylines. And then inside the cells of the lower level, you would have a list of stories, principal stories, a list of attractions, and a list of products. And this framework then can be used by all different kinds of users in a heritage site. The guides, the interpretive guides come up and they look, well, this is the message I want to use. I don't have to come up with the message myself. For those of you who were in my talk the other day, local guides aren't really good at coming up with the messages. They don't have to. And it also has a list of stories. So these are the stories I could tell, among others. Or if I happen to be a guy who specializes in the valley, that's where I work, then I say, well, what is the best message and the best stories that I could potentially tell in the valley where I work? Or from the Ministry of Tourism, I now have a groupings, a way to group the attractions in a site and give meaning to that site. Perhaps just the community members themselves could tell these stories in this new context to have a deeper understanding of their own site. So there's a variety of different uses. Information that's locally generated, but now organized in a communication framework that hopefully increases the heritage value, both for internal audiences and external audiences. Finally, it's the ideal would be that this framework would exist in an institution that already specializes in heritage conservation. For example, in a town like Évora, the municipality has a history department. So they would be in charge of keeping this and adding to it, adding new stories as they come up, or changing products. Or maybe in the case of Union Island, it would be a nonprofit conservation organization like Sustainable Grenadines, with whom we're working. In the case of a university, because we've done this with Katia University, the communications department would be in charge of this, because they would use these stories and these messages as they produce a variety of different kinds of communications. We haven't got to that point yet. We haven't got to the point where an institution has become the manager, of this interpretive framework. That's the future.
Just to be a bit of an SD, mm-hmm. I'm wondering...
What's an SD?
A root word disturber. I'm just wondering what happens if you do all this process and then some old guy in the back of the room looks up and goes, well, and this is like an example from a project I worked on. We have a real problem with mental health issues in our community. How is any of this going to help with those issues? So I don't really understand why we aren't identifying community needs first.
It's a different, what product would you want to generate? That's a different product.
We were developing a cultural center, uh-huh. And we were interpreting local culture. And as soon as he said, we have a problem with mental issues, we had to rethink our, we had to think, well, what is it in your culture that you feel is producing issues, and start talking about residential schools, colonialization,
Answer a little bit just because time is up. And as with any workshop, there is an objective to the workshop, and there are a certain set of ground rules within which you generate a consensus. In this particular workshop, people are invited because they want to contribute to the ideas about this particular place.
If the ideas have no agenda, then I'm not sure how they contribute to actually the community creating a sense of body.
Then we can talk a little bit afterwards, because people are always going to be more than happy to. I don't want to hold you any longer. I see Gail's already here. So I do have a couple of examples. Again, informally, if someone wants to come over, I'd be more than happy to show them. But otherwise, I want to thank you for coming. This was very brief, for example. The module itself, I also have the plan that I threw down on the floor, is actually the written up step-by-step how to do this kind of module, this particular workshop.
And I'll just show some examples for anybody who wants.